fired into the whole way our kind of area's functioning. So we need to make sure that the suits will be funded to make sure that our local area, our local economy can continue to thrive. Okay, can I move the recommendation to paragraph 2 of the report, if that's agreed? Item 9 is Transport for the North's draft strategic transport plan. Suzanne's going to say the chair for this panel.
Most of you should be aware by now that on Sunday this week, the subnational transport body, Transport for the North Regulations 2017, came into force, thus establishing Transport for the North as the first subnational transport body in the country. Accordingly, they are developing a strategic transport plan, and once it's gone through the draft status, it will become a statutory document which will basically format and help shape transport policy across the Liverpool City region as well. It's quite a weighty document, and we've sort of been through it, and we have worked with Transport for the North in developing the transport plan, so it's not just sort of been done in isolation, we have been had input all along the way. It's worth noting that the response to the consultation set out in Appendix 2 largely echoes a lot of the comments that have been made at those meetings throughout the development of that transport plan. So they won't come as a shock to Transport for the North, as it were. They are pretty much the same comments that we've been making throughout the process. Obviously, we're incredibly supportive of it because we've been very heavily involved in the process, but it is just sort of worth reiterating that the comments are pretty much what we've said all along. Fundamentally, our response centres around four key areas. We've highlighted the fact that in terms of connectivity, it's important to recognise that the North East has got a very polycentric zone. It's not just about one area, it's not just about focusing on one district centres, and anything that develops and encourages transformational economic growth really has got to focus on all of the key centres and not just on a handful like Manchester and Leeds. It's important that we recognise that all of the key centres are important. Obviously, given the nature of sort of where we are as well as a port area, we've advocated the great use of northern ports repeatedly through the development of the document as well, recognising that the work that we've done as part of the development of our own freight logistics strategy will come out into that as well, really highlighting the importance of freight to the city region economy. We've also highlighted the importance of the visitor economy, not just particularly for this area, but across the North as a whole, really recognising the role that the visitor economy does actually play in developing the assets and townscape that in itself can make the North attractive for inward investors. So not just sort of seeing it as an isolated thing, it really is a building block for wider investment. And really at every opportunity, we think that Transport for the North should be highlighting the importance of rebalancing the economy. It does appear throughout the document, but we do think that it might be given more prominence and really re-emphasise that every available opportunity to really sort of make sure that what the document sets out to do, it can actually fundamentally achieve. The deadline for the consultation is the 17th of April, so notwithstanding any comments that come from members today, we are proposing that the response in Appendix 2 gets sent to TFN as effectively a holding response or a substantive response, and then we'll be taking it to the combined authority in a couple of weeks' time, later on in this month, on the 20th, thank you, Deb. And then obviously any comments that come out from there, we have got agreement with TFN that they can be sent as a supplementary response as well. So that's it in a nutshell. If members have got any queries on the response itself or the contents of the draft strategic transport plan, I'm sure Mick will be able to handle them.
Thanks, Jim. Thanks, Suzanne. Again, you know, you've hit upon the points, listened very well, and again, excellently presented. Transport for the North. I mean, population wise, there's more people in the North than what there is in the London area, but yet we don't seem to get the same amount of money up this end, this end is what we do down there. You know, our population is greater, manufacturing is greater, everything about it is greater, apart from the money that goes into it. It's also pleasing to see that this isn't just highlighted on the Mersey Tram there, it's the North. And this is what we're looking at precisely is the North. I mean, you know, I just come up the A14 on the weekend. Felixstowe in the 60s, biggest container port in the country. We're still doing the A14 to connect it up to. I mean, we've got the part CFAR, the super part. Well, what have we done there to sort of get in front of it? You know, Dublin's been thrown, connectivity. We've still got Switch Island, two motorways coming to traffic lights instead of being linked. I mean, all this should have been looked at and done years ago. I mean, I've been saying to Mick for this years, no wonder he's gone, right? But I'm also rather tired of it. But, you know, these things should have been up front years ago. I was just talking about them now. I was just setting up Transport for the North. So unless Transport for the North has given some teeth and allowed to bite the government's backside in the Treasury to get some money up here, I don't know where we're going to go. But other than that, we're starting off now on the good report on the way forward.
Absolutely, Ken. This Mick's got it. I'm a bit jealous of it, but it's a bit in those terms. But no, seriously, you're absolutely right. For so long, the north of the country has been overlooked in transport and infrastructure funding terms. And seriously, in pulling together Transport for the North, which has genuinely been a northern endeavour, it was those of us across the north that have actually kind of pulled this agenda together. It's been a real good northern feat. He's very prescient to make those comments because obviously this afternoon, the very first meeting of Transport for the North has finally a statutory body is being held in this very building. So that's a great opportunity for this city region, and all of those arguments that you just articulated, I have no doubt whatsoever that will be kind of made this afternoon, because now we are a statutory body, the government has to listen to us, we can't ignore us, and if they try to, where would we tell them? Go on.
What we need for improving the rail network. It's difficult in a to work like this to actually encompass everything that's actually going on. But I think you can be assured that your offices really are pushing for improvements on the rail network, not just in terms of access to the port, but right across the city region.
I absolutely know that. I want to live there. It's just that within this document, being a statutory document in the future, if it's held on record, which would be at this time, we never put it into that. That's all. I do know, and I know Councillor Robinson's got the particular portfolio on the CA, and I know the officers are working on it. It's just what seems like a couple of things needs to be lifted up.
Yeah, if we can amend the board. Ron?
Yeah, just on the back of that, I think it's really important that Transport start to show some teeth itself. Regardless, because taken to the fact that we are a more strategic area, because we have our strategic port, and the expansion plans for the port by being forced themselves. And obviously, they're looking at additional rail link and rail line into the port to take some of the traffic off the road. It's that thing that the government should be driving forward and asking the government to fund what is significant works. But they are strategic to take vehicles off the road. I'm hating to be kind of probably on the bigger subway. And the amount of mileage that lorries do, bringing goods from south to north alone, because of the amount of goods that come through also Southampton, Felixstowe, etc. And because they come through also, we are the major ports for the north and we are going up to Scotland. I think it's very important that they start to, while they have a draft strategic plan, when they come to the plan that they want to go forward with the government, you have real teeth to it and say, if you want this to happen, you have to pay for it. That's the reality of things. You know, instead of coming back to say the local authorities want everything, the government needs to step up now. They want the economy to drive forward. That's really going to do it. I'm sure the links are there and the funding is appropriate for it.
Thanks for that. Ron, any further questions or comments? If we can thus agree to recommendations in paragraph 2 of the report, subject to the points Gordon raised, if we can just factor those in. But otherwise, I can thank all the officers for all the sort of hard work and the detail and the technical board and feedback before that. Okay, last few items. Public question time. We haven't received any public questions this meeting. Petitions and statements. We have received a petition from William Shortall. William's not with us today, but the statement is appended to the chair's note that everyone should have had, with a response from myself. I'm not going to read out either William's statement or the response. William not being here, we'll send it to him so he gets that officially. But needless to say, he raises some very important points that certainly myself and Ron will be raising with the bus operators. There's no urgent items of business at the meeting, so thank everyone for today's attendance. We look forward to seeing everyone at the next meeting, which will be the annual meeting in June. So we look forward to seeing everyone there.
Thank you.